So once while sitting in ENT emergency, a 13-year-old boy came with a profuse bleeding from nose. And his mother was telling that this boy is having recurrent attacks of similar episodes since the last 6 months. So it was bleeding profusely, and without even looking into the nostril, the first diagnosis which comes to our mind is juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma, an adolescent boy with a profuse bleeding, painless profuse bleeding from the nose. It is juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. So today I'll explain what is juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma, and under it have the theories of origin of juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma, the pattern of spread of JNA, and the clinical features, investigation and treatment, including different surgical approaches for excision of juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. Okay, angiofibroma was recognized very early in ancient times by Hippocrates, but the term as juvenile angiofibroma was coined by Friedberg in 1940. It was recognized much earlier by Hippocrates. Okay, and this is a locally invasive tumor, benign and locally invasive, and it has got property of invading into the intracranial cavity. Okay, and this occurs exclusively in males, but there are reports of very rarely happening in females also, and this constitute less than 0.5% of all head and neck tumors. And what is the site of occurrence of this angiofibroma? This happens most commonly in spinopalatine foramen. Spinopalatine foramen is a commonest site. Spinopalatine foramen is in the lateral wall of nasal cavity posterior to the middle turbinate. Okay, so the common site is the spinopalatine foramen. It can also happen in Vidian canal, and also this can arise from pterygoid wedge. And this pterygoid wedge is a common site of recurrence after surgery. Okay, so the most common site is the spinopalatine foramen. So the answer to what is angiofibroma is that it is a benign but locally invasive tumor with having property of intracranial extension, and the term coined by Friedberg in 1940, exclusively happening in adolescent males but can very rarely happen in females also, and constitute less than 0.05% of all head and neck tumors, and most commonly originating from spinopalatine foramen. Since the exact etiology is not known, there is overflow of theories of origin of JNA. Every year there came one theory, and the most accepted theory is hematoma and vascular malformation theory. So we will see one by one. In 1938, the first thing before coining the term of angiofibroma was coined in 1940. Before that, in 1938 came the Ringert's theory that tells that this angiofibroma arises from the periosteum of skull base bones. Okay, periosteum. Originating from the periosteum of bones forming the skull base. And in 1940, Soham and Nafsen's theory is that because there is disproportionate growth of the bones forming the skull base, there is hypertrophy of periosteum of these bones. The bones forming the skull base grow disproportionately, which leads to hypertrophy of the periosteum, and this along with the hormonal stimulation. Remember that this JNA is most commonly seen in adolescent males. So there is something related to hormones, and this hypertrophy of the periosteum combined with the hormonal stimulation will lead to formation of angiofibroma. Okay, so this periosteum plus hormonal stimulation. This Benjen-Ewing's theory in 1941 tells that, you know, that basis sphenoid and basis occiput forming the roof of nasopharynx. So between this basis sphenoid and basis occiput, there is a fibrocartilage. And this embryonic fibrocartilage between this basis sphenoid and basis occiput proliferate to form this JNA. So proliferation of fibrocartilage between basis sphenoid and basis oxygen. Bench shaving theory tells us proliferation of fibrocartilage between basis sphenoid and basis occiput. And Bremner's theory in 1942, it tells that JNA arises from conjoint pharyngobasilar and buccopharyngeal fascia. Okay, pharyngobasilar plus buccopharyngeal fascia. And JNA arises from a conjoint these two fascias. And regarding Martin's theory, it tells us an hormonal imbalance. So in adolescent, there are two hormones acting are estrogen and androgen. Okay. So when the estrogen level increases and or reduction in androgen lead to formation of JNA. Okay. So either estrogen should increase or androgen should decrease or both should happen. So estrogen levels increases, androgen level decreases, leading to formation of JNA. That is Martin's theory. And 1954, two theories formed. Sternberg's and also Handusa's theory was proposed in 1954. And Sternberg's tells us this JNA are nothing but hemangiomas arising from the skull base. Okay, they are hemangioma. And what this theory proposes that this JNA is a true neoplasm arising from the periosteum. Again, the role of periosteum comes there. It's a true neoplasm arising from the periosteum of basis occiput. Okay, again, periosteum. This Osborne gave two theories. Can be either a pseudotumor or it can be a true tumor. So pseudotumor, because he proposed it as an erectile tissue arising or arising from the skull base and proliferating under the influence of hormones. So fetal erectile tissue proliferating under the influence of hormones. So it is a pseudotumor, or it can be a true tumor, in the sense it can be a hamartoma also. So these two theories in 1959 and in 1973, these two gentlemen noted a resemblance between JNA and paragangliomas. Okay. And though there are so many theories, the most accepted one is hamartoma and vascular malformation theory. Okay, you should remember this. What is it? Hamartoma and vascular malformation theory. This can be hamartoma or vascular malformation, which is proliferating under the influence of hormones. So this is present day, the accepted theory is this one. And 2004 again, there is a branchial arch artery theory was proposed, because this They propose that this persistence of first branchial arch artery is the cause of this JNA, first arch artery. And we know that the first branchial arch artery is seen in relation with the spinovertebral foramen and also the pterygoid wedge. So this one is again an accepted one. But the most accepted thing is hamartoma and vascular malformation theory. It's a proliferation which is under the influence of hormones. So this, you have to remember this. Sometime this will be asked in postgraduate, not for undergraduate, for postgraduate theory or discussion, this can be asked.